Now, our next guest is on a mission to visit every country in the world without setting foot on an airplane. Oh. Thor Pedersen is a Danish adventurer. He's been travelling for 8 years and has just 7 countries left to go. And Thor joins us now. It's such a pleasure to have you in the studio here. The story is fantastic. It's really great. We just mentioned there's 7 countries you haven't visited yet.
Right.
First off, what are the 7 countries? And then, most importantly, why are you doing this?
Okay. Well, the easy one is the first off. So the remaining countries are New Zealand, there's Samoa, Tonga, Vanuatu, Tuvalu, and then Sri Lanka and Maldives. And then hopefully, finally, I can go home after all of this.
And then you've been everywhere in the world.
Not everywhere, but to every country.
Every country in the world, yeah. And why?
Well, it turns out no one's ever done this before. So if I complete this, I'll be the first to visit all the countries in the world in one unbroken journey completely without flying.
Yeah, the without flying part how are you getting around? How are you crossing oceans?
Crossing oceans on board ships, not swimming, fortunately not.
Like cruise liners, like you living
up on a
cruise?
I have been on a few cruise ships within the Caribbean, within the Pacific, and then especially lately with the pandemic and whatnot, no cruise ships whatsoever. So it's been container ships.
How do you make contact with the companies that run the container? Because they're not meant for passengers.
No, that's true. So it's a really unique project, and sometimes that opens up some doors that are otherwise closed. And I think the first container ship I got on board was by far the hardest because there was no reference point. They didn't know who I was doing. I hadn't gotten far into the project. But at this point, a lot more doors are open.
Yeah. Right, and people are being helpful with you now?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, absolutely. With the shipping companies are amazing. They put me on board these ships. It's a really privileged position to be in.
Yeah.
But people in general, opening up their homes, serving me food, pointing me in the right direction, translating. I mean, when I came to Australia in Townsville, Kara, she reached out and said she had a guest room I could stay. She drove me around, showed me Australia, at least that part.
So kind of as word spreading around the world, you don't have to share your story as much because it's being shared by other people who are kind of wishing you well and helping you along the way.
Well, I think now that I'm towards the end of the project, even more so. People, they're more excited now than... You go to the first 10 countries, nobody cares because that's very doable.
Yeah.
But you come to, this is my country number 196 of a list of 203. Wow. So I think there's a lot more interest at this point.
How about from your own point of view? I mean, where is your interest sit in terms of, are you at this stage just getting to places ready to move on to the next place, or are you getting to enjoy the places that you're visiting?
A bit of both. So when I left home, it was a great adventure. 90% adventure and 10% work. And then 6 months, 1 year, 2 years pass, and then it's more like 90% work and 10% pleasure. And now we're 8 years in.
Yeah.
So I really want to go home. Yeah. But at the same time, I'm traveling as a goodwill ambassador of the Danish Red Cross. So I've been meeting up with the Red Cross all around the world and trying to promote their work and the humanitarian efforts. I'll also be visiting with the Australian Red Cross here. So that's a part of the motivation.
Yeah.
I'm trying to focus on the positive within each country around the world. So try to promote countries as well as I can. And it's easy with your country, Australia. Everybody loves Australia. But, you know, some people are surprised to hear good news from North Korea or from Syria or from Yemen and whatnot.
What was North Korea like?
A lot different than the rumors. But still a very different country compared to your average country around the world. It's a very, very strict country in many ways, but still full of people and families and children that do go to school and farmers that go into the fields and whatnot. So it was very, very poor.
Yeah.
Do you rely on the Red Cross to be able to go into a place like that, like North Korea?
So
or how did that come about?
There's tourism to North Korea. It's quite restricted. You can go as an individual with a guide or you can go in a group with guides.
Yeah.
And then I came in without flying, obviously, so I got to see far more than people who just fly into the capital. I travel about 300 Ks over 5 days within the country. And, you know, you see that the government certainly has funds pay for some statues and nice museums and hotels and whatnot. And that's one part of North Korea. But at the same time, when you travel around, you get to see what's between all of those investments. And that's the real North Korea. It's people. They have mountains and rivers and beaches and whatnot. It's a beautiful country.
That's so interesting to me, like, without kind of pointing people out or whatever, but have you come across, like, have you had any troubles anywhere?
Oh, yeah.
And how's that dealt with? Or what type of troubles, first off, have you been encountering?
I was on a ship which was in a great storm in the North Atlantic in the wintertime. It was a ship that was not ice-class. And we had ice sightings in the region. We weren't far from where Titanic went down.
Right on.
The ship was all over the place, and I thought for sure there was no way that we would be able to survive this. But the seafarers were experienced, and they took care of me, and they were laughing, saying, we've seen much worse. So it was fine, and we made it across. In Central Africa, I was in a taxi going through a jungle for hours and hours in the middle of the night. We were all alone. We hadn't seen anyone, no villages, no people, no anything. And then suddenly there are three shadows in front of us in all the dust that's being shook all around the car. And they stop the car, they command us out. They're drunk out of their mind, they're armed to the teeth and very, very hostile. And I thought for sure that was the end of everything. Nobody knew that I was there. Nobody would come looking for me. I could easily disappear.
Wow.
It was a stressful situation. But for the most part,
yeah,
it's like 99% people just going to the markets, people going to visit family, people going to work, people going to school. People are very chill.
Yeah.
Everyone that I reach out to, more or less, they are willing to help within some capacity.
How about kind of currencies and stuff? I mean, when you're putting your hand in your pocket from a day to day, like what's your budget looking like? Are you kind of, are you ever concerned that today I'm not going to eat? I'll wait till I get to Africa or somewhere.
No, I'm not terribly concerned that I wouldn't be able to eat. Again, because people would help me. I'm very confident people would help me. I have a budget of $20 per day. So that's an average cost. Australia's not $20 a day.
Yeah, for sure.
We're leaving today.
Cost of living is a huge issue in Australia, especially.
Yeah, I haven't had anything to eat for 4 days now, so no, just kidding.
Yeah. I was looking around. I don't even have anything to give you.
So, are you serious that $20? You can't live on $20 a day in Australia?
No, I can't. So it's an average budget. It covers transportation, accommodation, meals, and visas. Mm. I don't really adhere to that budget when my wife is here, which she is now.
She just then came here. Yeah, of course.
We have a little bit extra to go out and spend and stay.
Your new wife as well. When did you get married? And how did you get married?
Well, I was in Hong Kong for 2 years during the pandemic. Hong Kong was very, very shut down, as Australia was, and she couldn't come to Hong Kong. I was about to say Australia. She couldn't come to Hong Kong unless we were married. So, we couldn't get married because I was in Hong Kong. She was in Denmark.
Yeah.
But then we heard you can get married through an agency in Utah, in the United States.
All right.
Wow. Sort of like through Zoom.
Did you have a Zoom wedding?
Yeah, we did.
Oh.
So it was 4 a.m. at night for me. It was midnight for her in Denmark and a comfortable midday in Utah. And do you? Yes, yes. And then we were married and then eventually got the paperwork, processed that in Hong Kong. She flew in.
This is fantastic. Guys, this story is unbelievable. Congratulations. The story is unbelievable.
Much.
I'm going to keep following it 100%. You can follow Thor's adventures on social media too and on his blog at Once Upon a Saga. And you'll see there where you can also support his travels for the Red Cross. Thor Pedersen, thanks so much for joining us. Oh, a fascinating story.
We could pepper you with questions all day long. So happy for 100%. Your family reunion as well that your wife is able to
Thank
join you.
Yeah, very kind
finally.
Of you.
Great work. Keep it up.
Thank you very much.
Well